Herman and I finally locked our store, dragged ourselves home to South Caldwell Street. It was 11 p.m., Christmas Eve of 1949, when we were dog tired. Ours was one of those big old general appliance stores that sold everything from refrigerators and toasters and record players to bicycles and dollhouses and games. We'd sold almost all of our toys, and all of the layaways except one package had been picked up. Usually Herman and I kept the store open until everything had been picked up. We knew we wouldn't have awakened very happy on Christmas morning, knowing that some little girl's gift and some little boy's gift was back on the layaway shelf, but the person who had put a dollar down on that package never appeared. Early Christmas morning, our 12-year-old son Tom and Herman and I were out by the tree opening up gifts. But I'll tell you, there was something very humdrum about this Christmas. Tom was growing up. He hadn't wanted any toys, just clothes and games. And I missed his childish exuberance of past years. As soon as breakfast was over, Tom left to visit his friend next door, and Herman disappeared into the bedroom, mumbling, "I'm going back to sleep. There's nothing left to stay up for anyway." So there I was alone, doing the dishes, feeling very let down. It was nearly 9 o'clock, and sleet mixed with snow cut the air outside. The wind rattled our windows, and I felt grateful for the warmth of the apartment. Sure glad I don't have to go out on a day like today, I thought to myself, picking up the wrappings and ribbons strewn around the living room. And then it began, something I'd never experienced before, a strange, persistent urge, go to the store. It seemed to say. I looked at the icy sidewalk outside. "That's crazy," I said to myself. I tried dismissing the thought, but it wouldn't leave me alone. Go to the store. Well, I wasn't going to go. I'd never gone to the store on Christmas Day in all the 10 years we'd owned that store. No one opened shop on that day. There wasn't any reason to go. And I didn't want to go, and I wasn't going to go. For an hour, I fought that strange feeling. Finally, I couldn't stand it any longer, and I got dressed. "Herman," I said, feeling silly, "I think I'll walk down to the store." Herman woke up with a start. "What for? What are you going to do there?" "Oh, I don't know," I replied lamely. There's not much stuff here to do. I think I'll just wander down to the store." He argued against it a little, but I told him that I'd be back soon. "Well, go on," he grumbled, "but I don't see any reason for it." I put on my gray wool coat and a gray tam on my head, then my galoshes and red scarf and gloves, and once outside, none of those garments seemed to help. The wind cut right through me, and the sleet stung my cheeks. I groped my way along the mile down to the 117 East Park Avenue, and slipping and sliding all the way, I shivered and tucked my hands inside the pockets of my coat to keep from freezing. And I felt so ridiculous. I had no business being out in that bitter chill. There was a store just ahead. I sighed and announced radio electronics store and service. and the big glass windows jutted out onto the sidewalk. But what in the world? In front of the store stood two little boys, huddled together. One looked to be about 9, and the other was probably around 6. "Here she comes," yelled the older one. He had his arm around the younger one. "See, I told you she would come," he said jubilantly. The two little children were half frozen. The younger one's face was wet with tears, but when he saw me, his eyes opened wide and his sobbing stopped. "What are you two children doing out here in this freezing rain?" I scolded, hurrying them into the store, and I turned up the heat. "You should be at home on a day like this." They were poorly dressed. They had no hats and no gloves. In their shoes, they barely held together. And I rubbed their small, icy little hands and got them up close to the heater. "Well, we've been waiting for you," they replied, the older boy. They had been standing outside since 9 o'clock, the time I normally opened the store. "Where and why are you waiting for me?" I asked, astonished. "Well, my little brother Jimmy didn't get any Christmas." He touched Jimmy's shoulder. "We want to buy some skates. We like some skates. That's what we want. We have these $3. See, Miss Lady?" he said, pulling the money from his pocket. I looked at the dollars in his hand, and I looked at their expectant faces. And then I looked around the store. "I'm so sorry," I said, "but we've sold almost everything. We have no skates." And then my eyes caught sight of a layaway shelf with its one lone package. I tried to remember what it is in it. "Wait a minute," I told the boys. I walked over and picked up the package, unwrapped it, and miracle of miracles, there was a pair of skates. Jimmy reached for them. "Lord," I said silently, "let them be his size, please." The miracle added upon miracle, they were his size. When the older boy finished trying the laces on Jimmy's right foot and saw that the skate fit perfectly, he stood up and presented the dollars to me. "No, no, I'm not going to take your money," I told him. I couldn't take his money. "I want you to have these skates, and I want you to use the money. You go get some gloves for your hands. You're freezing." The two boys just blinked at first. Then their eyes became like saucers, and their grins stretched wide when they understood I was giving them the skates and I didn't want their $3. What I saw in Jimmy's eyes was like a blessing. It was pure joy. It was so beautiful. My low spirits just rose up. And after children had warmed up and I turned down the heater and we walked together, as I locked the door, I turned to the older brother and said, "How lucky that I happened to come along when I did. You'd stood out there much longer, you'd have frozen. But how did you boys know that I would come? That's what I want to know." I was prepared, but I really wasn't. I wasn't prepared for the reply. Their gaze was steady, and he answered me softly. The tingles in my spine weren't from the cold anymore. God had planned this. As we waved goodbye, I turned to go home to a brighter Christmas than I had left. Tom brought his friend over to our house. Herman was out of bed, and his father, Papa English, and Sister Ella, they came by. We had a wonderful dinner and a wonderful time. But the thing that was made that Christmas so really wonderful was the one thing that makes every Christmas wonderful. Jesus Christ was there.